Okay, so today's lecture we are going to discuss about implementation of state machines using registers and counters. You may be aware of some of the details of this lectures, but so we will do a very quick review and then also get into a little more details about timing and speeding up such designs and so on. Registers and latches are basically nothing but an array of flip-flops. Edge-triggered ones are generally referred to as registers, while level-triggered ones are referred to as latches. Unfortunately, there is this is more a practice rather than this. There's a lot of variation in this nomenclature. Sometimes people tend to refer to as registers almost all storage devices. Similarly, sometimes people refer to even edge-triggered flip-flops as latches. But primarily, we will try to distinguish between them. So whenever we are talking of registers, we are talking of edge-triggered. And whenever we are talking of latches, we are talking of level-triggered. So we will just see the difference between the two. Normally, the symbol that we draw is a box with a D input and a Q output. The reason that I have shown this as multiple lines is that there could be this could be n bits wide. So you could have an 8-bit register or a 16-bit register. And this clock is common. That is, the data is transferred, the D data is transferred to the output Q with the clock. Of course, whether it is an edge or a level, that could be different. But the clock is common to all the n bits. So that's a fundamental, property of this type of a symbol. These are also called, this level-triggered ones are also called transparent latches. The reason they are called transparent is that the data, as we will see in case of a level, the data, the output is, the input is visible at the output, so that's why the transparent word. So let me just clarify what this edge and level mean and how would they, in terms of their input-output, how will they differ. So here what we have is a clock. So we start from with a clock, and then we have a D input. If you look at this, at the time when the change is happening, the D input is changing from 0 to 1 here, and then back from 1 to 0 here. Now if you look at the waveform that you generate for level-triggered case, the waveform that you will generate for level-triggered case corresponds to this. Because this level-triggered latch is transparent, so at the time when I'm assuming that it is the active level is the one that is high, the latch is active high, and so it becomes transparent when the clock is high. So during the period when clock is 1, any change in the input will be reflected at the output. So when D is changing, the output is changing. So this is the output for a level-triggered. But what happens is, let us say when this 1 to 0, this particular transition is taking place when clock is low. So this is not going to get reflected till you actually have the clock goes high. So it becomes transparent, it actually transfers this input to output. So it almost, you can see that here the behavior is more like an edge, because this particular transition happened when it was inactive. So but if the level, it's at the active high level, then any input change is going to be reflected at the output. So this is how the output waveform will look like. And we will see that what are the advantages and disadvantages of this type of a latch. We will discuss that. But let's look at how will the waveform look like if I have my flip-flop to be not level-triggered but an edge-triggered flip-flop. In case of an edge-triggered flip-flop, it will be sensed only at the edge. So basically, though it became 1 at this point in time, but the rising edge has passed. So active edge in this case is rising edge. So rising edge has passed, so it will wait till the next rising edge. At the next rising edge of the clock, it will sense the input and transfer to the output. Similarly, when it's going from 1 to 0, so it is again will transfer it to the output only at the rising edge of the clock. So you can see that one thing that happens very clearly is now this particular waveform is completely synchronized to the clock. Whereas in this case, that's not true. This particular change is not really synchronized to the clock. The in-between change is preserved. But whereas in this case, it gets synchronized to the clock. And that is one thing that you get in an edge triggered, which you do not get in the level triggered. Of course, what I have shown is I had shown these lines where I have shown that things are changing synchronously. But obviously, from the time when the D changes, actually there will be a short delay. Because that delay will come because of the delay of the propagation delay of the gates that are inside the D flip-flop. So the D flip-flop itself will have a delay, and so this change will occur little later than that. Similarly, though I have shown that this is edge triggered and I have shown this particular line, but actually again this change will occur little later than the edge. On the other hand also, these changes will occur little later than the edge. So if you can see that, if you can ensure that all the input changes are going to occur only in the inactive state of the clock, if your inputs do not change in the active state of the clock, then there is really no difference between the behavior of the edge triggered and level triggered. But if input changes occur when the clock is in the active high, if the clock is active high flip-flop, then clock is act high, if the input changes occur, then the behavior is different. If you can ensure that all your input changes are only going to occur during the inactive period of the clock, these are the inactive period of the clock when the clock is low. So then there is really not much difference between using an level triggered flip-flop or an edge triggered flip-flop, because inactive changes during the inactive stage are not going to be. But if the changes occur sometimes during the active period of the clock and sometimes during the inactive period of the clock, then of course there is a difference between, as we have seen, the waveform that's different. There are some issues when you talk of the state machine. We will come back to this. Using an edge triggered is generally a very safe method of doing a design, is using an edge triggered flip-flop. Edge triggered is a more expensive flip-flop than level triggered. The level triggered flip-flop is much more cheaper. Edge triggered has, let's say, generally its advantages, and also is easier to design using edge triggered, but we will see that where the problems can come, or where one sometimes might like to use a level triggered flip-flop. So this is not something whether it is edge or level is not being shown over here. So that has to be shown separately. Typically, for example, if you show a clock and if you show like this, that means it's active high, rising edge triggered. If you show like this, then it means it's a falling edge triggered, and so on and so forth. Or you can show like this to indicate with the clock. So what I'm showing over here is the variation in terms of the control. So you have this register, and this register you have the D input, you have the Q output. You have simply a clock. At every clock edge you are transferring D to Q. Problem is, I also want to have a control. That is, I don't want to transfer at every clock. I only want to transfer selectively at certain clocks, this particular transfer. Otherwise I want to hold on to the previous value. If I want to have a register of that nature, what do I do? There are two possibilities. One possibility is I can gate the clock. That is, I don't give the clock. So after all, it is a rising edge of the clock which is going to be active. I sort of just mask this. If I mask this, then this edge will not come, and I can gate it out and I can remove. So that is one way of doing the design. The problem with such a gating is that if you are doing gating at different registers, later on when you do a data part design, we will see this problem. Then there is a problem of clock skew that can come in. So if the gate delays are not uniform, or if some things are gated, some are not gated, then these edges may differ in time, and that may create their own complications. So till very recently, gated clock designs are not considered. Like, you rarely did gated clock designs. Otherwise, you preferably tended to do a enable type of a design. That is, you have a separate control input, and if either sometimes it's called load, sometimes it's called enable, sometimes it's called load enable. All three names are used for this control input, and all three mean the same. The implication is D is going to be transferred to Q only when this particular signal is, if let's say this is active high in this case, so if this signal is 1. If there is a gating, of course, how this is implemented, it may be implemented by a gating, but that's internal. There are also other ways of implementing this. So depending upon, you can construct this as to be an input. And what you can do is, you can use this to select. So you basically have a multiplexer. So one input to the multiplexer is the present queue itself. So this is your flip-flop, and this is your D. So this one is always, this is going to the clock, and you are selecting this load, you are selecting using this. So what is happening now is, each time you are latching the data into the flip-flop, but whether you are latching the previous input or the new input you are selecting. So if you do not want to load afresh, you are loading the previous input, and if you want to load something afresh, then you are selecting this. So people also implement this type of register with a load or enable input in this manner, a flip-flop with a multiplexer. But recently what had happened is, because of the issues which are related to power, and clock is a big source of power dissipation in the chip. There are many chips, especially high-speed chips, where the clock line itself may consume almost 40% of the total power of the chip. Because it is going at all places, it's very high speed, it's toggling. And as we talked of in the introduction to the course, it is the transitions which matter, and clock is transiting all the time. So all the buffers that are present and so on. So because of this, again for low power designs, gating of the clock has again become a technique which is getting increasingly employed, that you don't want to send the clock unless it is required to be sent. Anyway, so one can achieve that through this by the gating of the clock, or one can achieve through this. The other control input that is sometimes present in a register is an output enable. Output enable is nothing but, this one is a tri-state register, if you want your output to be a tri-stated output and you want to disable the output, then you can use the output enable. So if output enable is inactive, that means your output is going to be tri-state, doesn't matter what happens to the rest of the circuitry. But if your output enable is active, if it is enabled, then you will get the flip-flop output at the end. So that's something about the registers. So registers are a fairly simple device because they are nothing but you just follow the flip-flops. Just have a set of flip-flops, connect them together, and you get a register. Let's look at counters. Counters are extremely important because they are used extensively for state machine design. Of course, they are also used extensively for data part design, for other implementing other functionalities. And we will look at some variations of the counters. So we have ripple counter. We will talk about this ripple counter, which is the very basic building block. And we have synchronous counters. So there's a difference between these two. In synchronous counters also, we have a very wide variety of counters. We have synchronous counters with synchronous controls, with asynchronous controls, or even with mixed controls. We will see some examples of this as we go ahead. Let's first look at the ripple counter, and how does this ripple counter work? This is a very, very simple design of a ripple counter. It's just a set of T flip-flops. So I have a clock. So this clock I give to the first T flip-flop. I tie all the T inputs to 1. When I'm showing this with a thick arrow, it all means it's all to 1 or to VCC. So all these T inputs are 1. So that means they are always in the toggle mode. Anytime you give a clock, it will toggle. The flip-flop will toggle. Of course, it could be rising edge or it could be falling edge. Okay, I think there is a mistake over here. So let me ignore this particular waveform. I will make a correction. So you consider the clock. Let us say if it is toggling at the rising edge. Let me show with the falling edge. It will be simpler. Let's say this is your clock. Now, let us say I have my flip-flops which are toggling at the falling edge. So the first flip-flop, what it will do is, Let us say initially it is 0, so it will become 1 over here. So this is my Q0 output. I call this as my Q0 output. And now I'm going to give this as a clock to the next stage, because this Q0 is the clock to the next stage. So what happens is, this is the edge that is going to be active. And if you look at this, so with this edge it will go to, so with this edge it will go from 0 to 1. It will toggle because T input is 1. So each time you get a clock, it will toggle. So this is the type of a waveform, and you can see that if you look at this, this is nothing but 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and so on. And you can keep on cascading such T flip-flops and you'll get a simple counter. But what is important about the ripple counter is, if you consider this, there is going to be a delay between these two. This delay is nothing but the flip-flop delay of the first flip-flop, because from the time your rising edge to the, you will have some delay. Now if you consider the second one, there will be a delay between this and this and this. So if you look at this, they will be, the second flip-flop will change after the first flip-flop has changed. Okay, so there is a, because this is a rising, this is a falling edge, this falling edge is going to toggle this, and this is going to be used as a falling edge, there is going to be a delay between these two because of the first flip-flop, there will be a delay between these two because of the second flip-flop, and so on and so forth. So if you can cascade 9, let's say 8 flip-flops, then if you consider the 8th flip-flop, it will be delayed considerably with respect to the clock. Because each flip-flop is going to give you a delay. So it is like the carry logic that you have in your adders. It's very similar to that, and this particular delay will propagate. So this is obviously, the implication of this is, there are two implications of this, and we will see that these are the advantages of the ripple, disadvantages of the ripple counter. If you look at the advantages, there is of course advantages, a very simple low-cost design. So such designing such T flip-flops is fairly simple, you don't need anything else. High-speed operation possible if outputs are not required to be synchronous. This is a point I will again come back to explain to you what I mean, that the linkage is only between the succeeding flip-flops. So if you just want to toggle the flip-flops and you do not care that all your outputs change simultaneously, you can operate at very high speed. There's no global communication. There's no clock going at all places. It's just that the neighboring cells are connected, and it's a very fast operation is possible. But fast operation under this condition that you don't want outputs to be synchronous. Disadvantages, of course, is delay is number of bits into the flip-flop delay. So each flip-flop, whatever it contributes, so if it is N into TFF, where TFF is the flip-flop delay. And you have illegal transient states. And this is also an important, so I will explain. So these two are related. Basically, if you can tolerate this, then high-speed operation is possible. Let me explain what I mean. So let us say, this is one flip-flop, which is changing from 1 to 0. This induces the other flip-flop, let us say, to go from 0 to 1. So what had happened is, this was in state 0, 1. Let us say this is Q1, this is Q0. And then it is going to the state 1, 0. But in between, because during the time that the flip-flop delay is there, this is your T flip-flop. During this period, you have a transient which is 0, 0. Because this flip-flop has still not gone from 0 to 1, and this flip-flop has gone from 1 to 0. And so because of that, there is a transient state which is 0, 0. So if you consider a large sequence, there will be lots of such transient states. Because each one will ripple through. So if you are going from, let us say, from the state 0, 1, 1, 1, let us say 4 bits, and the next state that you are going to go to is this is your LSB side, this is your MSB side. So from 0111 to 100, if you are going to go through, so you can see that this one will go to 0 first. So the number of transient states you will go to will be, the first transient state you will go to will be 0110. Then you will go to 0100. Then you will go to 0000 before you reach this. So you will actually go through these three transient states before you actually manage to reach the final state, and it will be. Of course, how depends upon your speed of operation. If your clock speed is very high and these delays are also of comparable time as the clock speed, let's say you're really operating your device at the maximum potential that the device can operate, then what it means is, if you consider the state, the total time at which this counter is going to be at state 8, corresponding to the output of 8, the state is 8. So then, 1/4 of the time it will be in 0110, 1/4 of the time it will be 0100, 1/4 in 000, and only for 1/4 of the time it will be in its valid legal state, if your operation speed is very high. So this is the problem that occurs in ripple counter, that you actually, so if you put a, if you have a counter and you put a decoder, and let us say you are, what you are expecting is this output 01 was high, and followed by that I should have, let me draw this. So let us say you have a 2-bit counter and you take this 2 bits output and you pass it through a decoder. You can actually conduct this experiment and even see it in the lab. So if you have the 0, 1, 2, 3, so what you had expected was that in terms of time, when the counter went from here to this, I should get the waveform. So what will happen is I will get the waveform like this, but in between I will also get a spike here, which is the spike which corresponds to the gap between these two. Because when I went from 01 to 10, I went through the state 00 and I, this particular decoder. So, of course, it all depends upon the speed of operation, but it's possible that, and this spike can play a, you know, disastrous role in your circuit if your circuit is sensitive to such spikes. So this is one problem with the ripple counter, and of course where this problem is not applicable, then you can use such counters. Synchronous counters do not have this problem, but they suffer from some other deficiency, and we will look at it. There are very interesting ways people have designed synchronous counters and also speeded up, and we will see some example of this. So in this case, the whole clock, the clock is passed on to all the flip-flops. So once you want to pass something on to all the flip-flops, obviously in today's technology, any type of a global routing implies that your circuit is going to be slower, okay? Because you are going to take this, if let's say you are building a very large counter, many times one needs to build large counters for doing just a division and things like that, so of the clock. So if you are building that, then this particular length, line length is going to be critical. It's going to go to many flip-flops. That's one thing. Second, of course, so what we do is now, we decide when each of the flip-flops should toggle. And here we use the fact that you are going from LSB to MSB. So this is your LSB side and this is your MSB side. The condition for any flip-flop to toggle is all the previous bits should be 1. Because if you are counting, if you are counting, so of course, so I am writing the LSB side on this side. So initially, of course, the LSB bit will toggle each time. So that's why I take the T input of this and tie it up. But this will toggle. So if you are, let's say I do a 4-bit count. So this is again, I'm writing MSB here and LSB here. So it's, I'm writing the reverse way just to show with this diagram. So if you look at this, this particular bit toggles when the LSB bit is 1. This is going to toggle when both these bits are 1 and so on. So I can generate that condition simply by generating an AND. So I can generate an AND, and so on. So that could be the condition that, so now this flip-flop is going to toggle only when in the next clock period. So in this particular clock period, it will toggle from 0 to 1 because this Q was 1 in the previous clock period. And that Q is going to enable this T. So at the time when the clock edge comes, because this is 1, this is still 1 and it has not changed to 0. It will of course change to 0 here. So this one will toggle when both of them are 1, 1, and then this particular AND gate is going to enable this particular T flip-flop to toggle. And in this manner, I can cascade all of them and I can generate. So what happens over here is, if you look at this type of a circuit, okay, again, no, this... So let us say I change it at falling edge. You can also work with rising edge, just some changes, small changes need to be made. So what will happen is if you look at Q0, each time Q0, because T input was 1, each time Q0 will toggle. So it will become 0, it will become 1, it will become 0, it will become 1. If you look at Q1, it is going to toggle here at the falling edge, because it's going to toggle only when Q0 is going to be 1. So it will 0, 1, 0 and so on. And so you can see that this is basically acting like a counter 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 and so on. If you look at the Q2, Q2 will toggle only when this is 1. Both of them are 1 and then this edge will come. And that is nothing but... So I will get a counter. So now, one thing that is important to notice over here is the way I am generating this, at the time when clock arrives, this output is 1. So what the implication is that all these delays, the delay, the longest path that is present over here should be smaller than the clock period. Because at the time when the clock comes, so even if I, let's say I have 8 flip-flops, so 7 AND gates will be present to generate the input to the 8th flip-flop, and the delay of all the 7 AND gates should be smaller than the clock period, because let us say when all of these are 1 and you are going through and going to change the 8th bit, then 8th bit should also be able to change. So that is the requirement that comes for synchronous counter. So what we have done now is, so that way it can become slower. Of course we will see some techniques by which it can be made faster. Yes.
Also add up
to, yes, 7 AND gates plus delay of the first flip flop. That will also add up.
If all the bits are toggling, then the AND gate has to wait for the flip flop to toggle and then only its output will stabilize.
Which one? No, it is a previous bit. It's not that I am going to toggle. I am only going to sense the rising edge. Not even the first flip flop. Let me just clarify what is happening. You are sensing this edge, okay? So this is the one that is there in the... So this particular flip-flop is going to go to 0. I'm not bothered about this state. I'm bothered about the previous state of the flip-flop. So the delay is only... The flip-flop delay will not add up. So this is... So basically, if this is, let's say we are talking of this. So they are already in state 1, 1, 1, okay? And they have reached this state in the previous clock, at the end of the previous clock. And in the next clock, this is going to toggle from 0 to 1. So I'm only sensing it at the edge, rising edge of the, or falling edge of the clock, depending upon what the edge is. And this should be stable. The output of this should be stable. And after the delays, it should reach. So it is not that. So all the edges, so that is a fundamental thing about this, that all your output changes, for example, if you consider this output change and this output change, they are synchronized. There is a flip-flop delay, but the same flip-flop delay is there for this as well as for this. If you look at this, all these three changes will be synchronized and they will all correspond to one flip-flop delay. Of course, there could be small variation because two devices may not have exactly the same delay. That's the device property. But the delay of this, delay of this, delay of this from the clock edge will be the same. So what happens is, it's only the delay of the AND gates that's important. The output of all these AND gates should be stable at the T input before the clock edge comes. All the ones that have occurred in the previous state. So it's not that the delay is going to come from this particular clock. The change that happens, and that's how the synchronous counter works. One simple way of speeding it up is, of course, rather than having multi-level ANDing, I can have two levels of AND, and that's fairly straightforward. Here what I'm showing is, I'm showing an external input enable, because many times what we need is, we need a counter which counts only when it is enabled to count. I want to go to the next state only when it's enabled. So I can connect this enable over here. This will toggle, so this is not connected to one, but this toggles only, and I connect AND gates over here. So this, what happens over here is, when this is enabled, and now you can see that I have reduced my clock can be speeded up compared to the previous case, because I'm generating a separate AND for this, separate AND for this, separate AND for this. So once these outputs are stable, it's only the maximum delay. So if, let's say, this 4 input AND gate has a maximum delay, that is the one that is going to restrict the clock. Okay? Not the sum of these 3 AND gates, because they are 3 are all independent. So once the clock comes and this stabilizes to 1, this stabilizes to 1, this stabilizes to 1. So for toggling, this is basically nothing but blowing up that, instead of having a cascade, I am having a two level, in this case single level, logic of AND gates for enabling each of the T flip-flops. So this type of a circuit is fine when one is building a counter which is a small counter. What do I do when I want to build a large counter? Because let us say if I want to make a 4-bit counter and I want to copy this 4-bit counter across to make 8-bit or 12-bit or 16-bit. So what I can do is, I can actually put an AND here and use this as an enable for the next stage. But then once I start increasing the number of stages, the delay of these AND gates will, let's say, if I have many stages, if I have, let's say, 32-bit counter, so 8 such AND gates will get added up, and that will become the limiting factor for, or 7 such AND gates will get added up, the delays of these, and that will become the limiting factor for what is going to be my fastest clock. There is a very interesting circuit by which this particular problem is solved in synchronous counters, and which are called cascadable synchronous counters. When you want to use cascadable synchronous counters, so I will spend a little bit time over this, because this is an interesting look-ahead trick. Basically, it is also a circuit which is also some type of a look-ahead, like we considered the look-ahead adders. So here, what I am considering is, I am considering each one of them is a 4-bit counter. So I am trying to make a 16-bit counter. Internally, these 4-bit counters could have been designed in this manner, the manner that I have shown, okay, to make them fast. But now when I want to make a 16-bit counter out of this 4-bit counter, what I do is, I have two enables for this counter. And a counter counts, so internally I propagate this, both the enables, AND them together, and the counter counts only when both the enables are active. So it's basically, as far as you are concerned, internally for this counter, both the enables are required to count. But one of the enables, so the two enables are different. Okay, one enable is used for propagation, another enable for toggling. So what it means is, if you consider this type of a circuit, this is basically for propagation. What happens over here is, this enable is 1, and all these counter outputs are 1. That means I am going to propagate the count. The next counter should count when all of them are 1. So now, I treat by the LSB, so this is my LSB side, LSB 4 bits, and this is my MSB side. I treat my LSB side a little differently than the other LSB and LSB plus 1. So these are the LSB 4 bits, these are the next 4 bits. So here, of course, I have done is I have taken this enable toggle, connected it to 1 permanently. And whatever is my enable input, that enable input I connected to this enable propagate input. So this is, of course, the overall enable for my counter. Only when this enable is there, my counter should count. Okay. Now I have taken this output. This is a carry output, is nothing but this particular thing is a propagation output. What it means is, this enable is 1 and all these 4 propagates are 1. For all these 4 bits are 1. So this enable, so this is that 5 input AND gate that I talked of. So this particular 5 input AND gate, that's the output of this 5 input AND gate. And so this particular carry output actually goes to all the enable T's for all this other 12 bit counter. And here, so I am this continuing here, I am making this enable propagate 1 and then taking the carry from here and giving it to enable propagate, carry from here and giving it to enable propagate. What is happening over here? You see, this is based on the fact that the fastest changing counter over here is, this is the fastest changing counter. These are changing slowly. If you consider this particular counter, what is the condition for this particular counter to count? The condition for this particular counter is, the first 4 bits should be 1 and the next 4 bits also should be 1. This is your let us say Q0 to 3, this is Q4 to 7, and then I will count my Q8 bit, the counter corresponding to the 8th bit will count when all of them are 1. Okay, so now, so what implication of this is, let us say if you, so for all the other conditions also, let's say if you, so not only for Q8, 11, for Q12, 15 also, these have to be 1 and these have to be 1. Then the first bit of Q12 will count, and Q12 also has to be 1 to count Q13. So what is happening over here is, if you consider these bits, so after, let us say, once you reach this, or before you reach this, you would have reached this stage. First you would have reached this stage. And after reaching this stage, after 16 clocks only you will reach this stage. It will take 16 clocks from go from here to here. Because I have reached 000 LSB. Let's say I'm talking of counting for this. So this is, let us say, going from 000 to, okay, so again I'm considering LSB on the this side and Q12 on this side and Q15. So first I reach this and then I reach this before, sorry. So first I will reach this, then I will reach this, and then I will reach that stage where so this to this takes 16 clocks and then I go from here to here. So I should have drawn this here, but let me just explain to you. So first I will reach this stage. It will take 16 clock pulses from go from here to here, and then 1 clock pulse I want to go from here to here. That's what I want, okay, in my counting, because there is some count I reached and then I count 16 clock pulses, I go from here to here, and then from in 1 clock pulse I go from. All these have to become 0 and this has become 1. Now, in this circuit what I have managed to do, if this is 1, if all these are 1 and all these are 1, so I have 16 clock pulses now for these ones to propagate to this particular, because these counters are now not changing at all. In the time period when this is happening, when I am counting from this stage to this stage, all these counters are, these two counters are already stable. They all contain, already contain these values. And so any number of stages you put, so they will all propagating through those AND gates that I have mentioned before. So there will be number of such AND gates, and through that the output will propagate. And it will remain at enable P. So it will come to this particular enable. But this enable will come, which is the next enable. This enable will come only when I reach this stage. So only when after I reach this stage, of course, but that, because this particular enable is directly going to all of them. It is being broadcasted to all of them. So that it will reach just after this flip-flops are stable. So immediately, so there is no propagation. Enable T is not propagated. It's the enable P which is propagated. So enable T is used locally only for enabling the count. So in the next clock period, once this has reached 111, this enable has already reached it before. And so what we have now is immediately all of them will toggle, including this will toggle immediately soon after. So now my clock period limitation will only come from delay of one counter and not the delay of all the four counters. That is, this particular propagation is neatly broken up and I don't have to bother. So actually what I have is, I have this carry delay. So let's say you consider this, not there are not four stages, but let's say there are 16 such stages. We are doing a 64-bit count. So what is happening is these 15 stages that we are going through will have a 16 clock cycles for propagating and not just one clock cycle for propagating. And this is essentially achieved by breaking this down. So, and using this directly. So the first stage output is directly used as enables for all of them, whereas the other stages are stable now. And because it's counting in this sequence, so I will have multiple number of clock cycles available. And so, of course, this particular constraint is much simpler constraint than the 15 delays are less than 16 clock cycles than saying that 15 delays are going to be less than one clock cycle. The implication is your clock cycle now can be much faster. And there is, and this is a particular process is something which is, you can make it even, let's say if you want to give not 16 clock cycles, but if you, let's say you want to give larger number of clock cycles, 256 clock cycles, I need to have two enables. One enable from here, one enable from here going through, and I can make them for the propagation. I can have 256 clock cycles rather than 16 clock cycles. But of course, typically 16 clock cycles are good enough for almost all types of designs. Why 16 clock cycles? The reason 16 clocks, you see, if you look at this, so first I reach this stage in my counting process. Then I reach this stage and it takes 16 clock cycles to reach this stage. And then I need to make this. This is the time when I want the fourth counter to count. Isn't it? Because this is 000 till now and it's going to go to 0001. This is the LSB side. So I want the fourth counter to count. But fourth counter has two enables. One enable it gets when it from here. Another enable it gets from all this period is there for these, because these are all ones, already 16 clock cycles before. So this propagation time that is allowed is 16 clock cycles. These counters are not changing during this stage. When you are going from here to here, these counters are all already all ones. And during this time, this enable P will propagate. Because enable P, this is one. So this one plus all ones will make this one. This one plus all ones will make this one and it will remain one. And it will just wait for this counter to go to all ones and it will toggle immediately. So we have just neatly broken it down into two parts. One coming from the first stage and one propagating through. The first stage one is not propagated, it's broadcast. Basically what we are doing is, one stage we are broadcasting and starting from the second stage we are propagating. And this achieves the result of speeding up the counters. So now we come to the aspect of designing with these counters, and let us so we also have to bother about the other type of counters, which is the relates to the controls. We will show this when I'm giving you the example. So this is the one I'm showing you with all possible types of controls that you have can have on counters. So you have a D input exactly like, so it is an n-bit counter. D is, typically such counters are called presettable or loadable counters. You can load a starting value with the D input. Or you can also load an in-between value also. If you want to skip states and so on and so forth, you can use it the D input. You have the clock, you have the clear input, you have the enable input, you have the load input. Load input is the one which loads D. Enable input is the one which enables the counter to count. And clear is the one which clears the counter to all zeros. Apart from these inputs, you also have counters which can have up-down inputs. You can have output enable. If you have a counter which counts both up and down, you can have one bit to control it, whether you are counting up or down. You can even have two bits, separate bits. Output enable is something, again your output is tri-state, then you can have a buffer and you can enable the output to be tri-stated or not. So you can get a various types of counters depending upon which of these controls are present or which of these controls are absent. A very simple design of a mod 10 counter. The functionality of this counter, so in case of counters, counters are basically like Moore machines. These are Moore machines with another property that the output is nothing but the state itself. Okay, simply a counter, if you look at a counter, it's a Moore machine with output being same as the state. So I'm not just specifying the output, I'm just specifying the state itself, and here I'm assuming that that's the same thing as the output. So if my state is between 0 and 8, I just go to the ST plus 1, I just add 1, I'm just incrementing. But if it is something else, so of course in this case, after 9 I want to go to 0 because it's a mod 10 counter. But if you actually happen to be in some other illegal state beyond 9, because a 4-bit counter actually can take states from 0 to 15. So you get back to 0 and then is 0 otherwise. So that's the property of this. So this particular diagram, if you represent it, basically you go like this. S9 and it's a free running counter. There's not even an enable. Otherwise, if you have an enable, then you can have an enable and you can say that if there is enable, enable is equal to 0 or enable is equal to 1 and so on. So you can put these arcs. So this is the state diagram that it represents, and this is the state diagram that one is implementing. So here I am showing implementation of this counter, implementation of this particular state machine using two counters. One is a synchronous counter, another is an asynchronous counter. And the difference is clear that what is required to be done. In case of synchronous counter, I have to decode 9. Because what I want is, once I reach 9, the next state that I should go is 0. Okay? So I have to go from... So if the next state is going to be 0, so I'm going to decode 9, and that's going to 9 is going to clear my input. So I'm using a synchronous counter. With a synchronous counters, of course, okay, let me say, it is not really the counters which I'm bothered here about, as the nature of the clear. This I should clarify. It's a synchronous clear, it's an asynchronous clear. What a synchronous clear implies is, if you consider in terms of the if I reach my state, my counter is in state 9, let's say it's all rising edge. So the counter is in state 9. My decoder output, of course 9 it will reach a little later, and my decoder output will come over here. There will be a little bit of a decoder output delay. Decoder here is nothing but an 4 input AND gate. Okay, 9 is decoded, when I say decode 9, 1001. So this is what I mean. So my decoder output, so this is my decoder 9 output, so this is going to come little later. So what is going to happen is, this is a rising edge triggered counter, so at this particular edge, I will actually sense that this decoder is 1, and because it's 1, I will go to state 0. So that's how I will implement a modulo 10 counter. But what I'm assuming over here is that the clear is synchronous clear. Implication of a synchronous clear is, the clear is going to be sensed at this rising edge. But if it is an asynchronous clear, I have to decode not 9, but I have to decode 10. The reason is, counting may be synchronous, but it is a clear process that I am right now concerned with. So what I will do is, this is 9 and this is 10. So I let the counter go to 10. So as soon as it reaches 10, I will generate a clear pulse. This is my clear pulse. And this will clear, and so what will happen is, counter will remain in 10 for a short period of time, and then it will go to state 0. Because the reason it's asynchronous clear is, this particular clear pulse, as soon as you apply the clear pulse, it gets cleared and it doesn't wait for the clock. Whereas in this case, though I have decode 9, this is my clear pulse, I have applied the clear pulse here, it just waits for the clock to clear. So this is, of course, in terms of the transient states, you can see that this, again, you are generating a transient state. If you look at the decoder output, you can decode 10 also for a very short period of time till it is clear. And the time period in which it is in state 0 is going to get reduced, because for part of the time it's going to be in state 10, and for rest of the time it will be in state 0. Of course, what is the ratio of this? That depends on how fast that you are operating. So such a thing is called an asynchronous clear. So what we have said is, you can have a counter with synchronous clear or asynchronous clear. The counter is synchronous in the sense that it counts synchronously, but it clears at different times. So we will just complete this discussion with talking about the realization of the same state machine that we had yesterday. How do we realize the state machine using a counter? So I have the same state machine and I have the same state encoding. And remember, in case of the implementation last time, when we are implementing with flip-flops, in this column we had, how are we going to generate the excitation inputs? Here also is exactly actually the same. For each column, I'm now realizing this with the counter, so for each row, I'm going to decide whether I should enable the counter, I should clear the counter, or I should load the counter. There are three inputs. My present state is 00, my next state is 01. So here I can enable it because I'm just going from 00 to 01. I'm just counting. So I will have 100 as the input.
Sir, here, what's the difference between that enable and the load signal?
Enable is you're just going to the ST plus 1, whatever is the state. Load is you are loading the D input into the queue. Load is, so we will see that we also are using the load. So when I'm using enable or clear, I don't have to bother about the D input, because enable and clear, the output is independent of what the D input is, so that's why I have a don't care. But when I go from present state 00 to 10, I cannot do either enable or clear. The only way I can go from 00 to 10 is by loading, and the value that I ought to load is 10. When I want to make a transition from 00 to 10. When I want to make a transition from 01 to 00, I can clear it, because clear will take me to 00. I can make a transition from 10 to 00 again by clearing, so that's why I have a 010 as input. I can make a transition from 10 to 01 by only by loading. Now, the issue is, I have 1001. Now the issue is, actually I can do away with all this and each time load. Each time for each input, present state to next state, I know that what is the state. So after all, I can just put that. I can put 01 here, I can put 00 here, I can put 00 here and do away with enable and clear. Then it will become like a register machine with a register. You don't need a counter then. Then but what is the advantage of using a counter? Advantage of using a counter is, please remember, this D is, these do not scale up. Even if you have 20, a counter of 20 bits, you still will have one enable, one clear and one load, irrespective of what is the size of your counter. Whereas this D, if it is a 20 bit counter, it will have 20 inputs. So, when it have a large number of inputs, then if I specify this at all places, circuit that I have to generate for each of the inputs is going to be extremely complex. If most of my transitions can be accommodated with enable and clear, only then actually I use a counter. If large number of my transitions are of count type or clear type. If most of my transitions are can be accomplished by enable or clear, at most places I need to put only don't care. So the logic that is generated for these large number of inputs is very, very simple. Only the loading is required only at few places and I can reduce the logic that is. And if all the transitions are enable or count, then I don't even require a D input. But let's say for a large state machine that cannot happen. But if a lot of your transitions are enable and load, then for few of them, enable and clear, then few of them where you require a load, you put the values. Rest of them you put don't care and minimize the logic. Once you do this, your circuit realization is very, very straightforward. The circuit realization is exactly as before. Convert the same table. Y is, of course, I not considered Y is the same thing as before. So you have the present state, which is the present state is the counter state. And from this you have to get the output, which does the excitation. So this is whatever this N value, this is also going to be N. But this is only going to be 3. Irrespective of what the value of N is going to be. So this is the way you can realize this. You can generate the enable, clear and load. Lastly, I will only talk of one more slide. And what we have over here is, I am giving you a sample counter specification. And this is a counter with mixed controls. I have controls clear, load, enable, clock, D. How do I read this specification? If I read this specification, I will read it in this manner. Clear is asynchronous. It does not require anything to do with the clock. Once I have my clear input to be at 1, my output is going to be 0. Load is synchronous because I also specified the clock for loading. When it is 1 and clock is rising edge, I have a D. Enable is of course synchronous. When it is 1 and I have a clock, my output is QT plus 1. In these cases, I don't. This type of a specification also gives me one more information that's very important, that because I have 3 control signals, which actually all of them influence the output, what dominates the other. In this case, clear dominates both load and enable. Once clear is 1, I don't care what the rest of it is, my output is going to be 0. And in this particular row, load dominates enable. Clear dominates both load and enable, and load dominates enable. If load is 1, I don't care whether it's enable or not, I get my D output. And in this case, of course, enable is the least dominating of the 3 inputs. So such a specification you should be able to read and specify what type of control it is. And as an example, I have given here a counter with mixed type of control. Some synchronous, load and enable synchronous, and clear asynchronous. We will stop with this. Thank you.